Nature wants us to be fat. This sounds a little bit crazy to say, but it's the title of a new book I just read by Richard Johnson. And nature does actually want us to be fat because it protects us from starvation. The issue is, most people are not at risk of starvation anymore. And essentially, this is what Richard Johnson talks about in this book. So in this video, I'm going to give you a short summary of the book and the key takeaways of what you can do to change your behaviors to improve your health psychologically and physically. So this book was quite science heavy. It has a lot of biochemistry in it. Richard Johnson is a nephrologist, and I think he thinks that other people enjoy knowing this like scientific mechanism as much as he does, but I'm not sure if that's the case. And I think it might be a little bit of a tedious read for some people, but that's okay. I read it for you, and I'm gonna tell you exactly what it says and how to implement those protocols to improve your life. Okay, so this whole title, Nature Wants Us to Be Fat, I love it. Like, I think it's just so accurate. And it really goes down to the issue of the fact that so many people try diets or weight loss protocols, and they try to improve their health because we all know that metabolic disease is this huge driver of illness. And nobody seems to be having a lot of success. Like, there's obviously something else going on, because it's not just people's psychology. It's not that they're not trying hard enough. It's not that they're not exercising hard enough, because people do want to be healthy. People do want to actually feel good in their own bodies, and people don't want to get metabolic diseases. Like, there is some kind of disconnect that's happening here, because we have all of this intention to be healthier, but we can't quite seem to achieve it. And also, why is this happening now at this point in history? Why did we not struggle with this as much 100 years ago? Like, what changed? Like, did those people have more self-control? Like, what's going on? And so Richard Johnson does an excellent job of explaining this. And it comes down to this concept called the survival switch. And understanding the survival switch, I think, is key to understanding metabolic disease and also mental disease, which he doesn't talk a lot about because he's not a psychologist or psychiatrist, but I would like to make that link as well. So I'm going to encompass all of this for you and really lay it out, like, how is this like happening? What's going on here, right? Okay. So the survival switch, the best way to think about the survival switch is to think about an animal that hibernates, like a bear. So a bear essentially gorges themselves on berries during the summer, and then when winter comes, they use that fat reserve to essentially sustain themselves through the winter. But what's key here is the gorging of the berries. So without gorging on berries, the bear would not necessarily be able to activate that hibernation response. And don't quote me on that, I am not like a bear specialist. So the bear eats a lot of berries, and berries are made up of a lot of fructose. Fructose is the sugar that is typically in fruit. Most sugars exist on a fructose-sucrose ratio. So table sugar has both, and some sugars are only sucrose, and some sugars are only fructose. There's actually other sugars out there, but for our kind of intended purposes, we only need to focus on these. So the bear is taking in a lot of fructose, and that signals to his body that he needs to go into this hibernation response. He needs to turn the survival switch. And the fructose metabolism triggers this uric acid production in the body, in which it's able to essentially turn on a bunch of survival processes that will allow the bear to sustain the winter, to sustain a period of no food. And essentially, turning the survival switch leads to an increase in hunger, lower energy, and more fat storage. So you can kind of imagine that this needs to happen for the bear. And as humans, we've accepted bear hibernation as like a normal thing. We're like, oh yeah, bears hibernate. Like, that's totally fine. What's interesting is that we never realized that this could apply to us as well. So we're not necessarily exactly like bears, because we don't actually hibernate. We don't engage in that process. But we do have a survival switch just like bears do. And what happens is that our survival switch is activated in a very similar way. And so many mammals have this, and we can study it in a lot of different mammals. But with humans, we also engage a survival switch when we intake high amounts of fructose. So let's talk about, where is this fructose? Like, where is it coming from, right? And so we know that we have a lot of high fructose corn syrup in a lot of our foods these days, which is like fructose on crack. Like it's essentially the crack of fructose, right? Like it's high fructose corn syrup. It's been distilled to the point where it's like extra fructose. And we all know this isn't great for us, but we didn't really know like how bad it was until recently, and that we know now it activates this mechanism in our body that essentially leads us to being tired, gaining a ton of weight, and just being hungry. And if we weren't ingesting these high amounts of fructose, we wouldn't have these effects. And that also helps us understand why are we able to gain so much weight now in relation to kind of our history when we weren't able to gain as much weight. Now that we have these types of beverages and foods that have such high amounts of fructose, in that they are distilled to completely unnatural amounts, we are able to engage that survival switch so easily, and it was not able to be engaged in this way in the past. And I think this is so important to understand because it explains so many of our diseases. These metabolic diseases and these psychological diseases that exist, we sometimes think like, why does this happen? Like, what is happening with nature that it would make us so, so sick? Like, why would this be a good evolutionary outcome? Like, why would we get heart disease, diabetes, depression? Like, why would this happen? And so this theory of this uric acid theory coming from high fructose consumption allows us to explain why these diseases exist, because they actually had a very protective purpose in the past. So we know that humans existed through our evolutionary history in times of feast and in times of famine. And in some of those times of famine, the famine was really intense, and there were only certain humans that survived. And this actually even goes back to our primate ancestors, who also had to exist in these types of dichotomies. So there were certain times in history in which fruit was abundant, and then all of a sudden we went into this drought or this famine, and we were not able to eat. And so what happened is that a lot of the individuals that survived essentially were the ones that were able to store quite a bit of weight when they were able to gorge themselves on the fruit and therefore prepare themselves for this kind of long winter or this long famine. And so we developed a mechanism in which we were able to activate the switch through a high amount of fructose consumption. And it made so much sense in the past because essentially we were able to consume a high amount of fruit, gain a lot of weight, decrease our energy, and that made a lot of sense when going through a famine or a drought period in which we needed that fat storage to survive, and it was worth it. Like, decrease in energy or just not feeling great or whatever was worth survival. Like, that's a small price to pay to not die in a famine. And those are kind of the trade-offs that oftentimes our minds and our bodies will make, because to the mind and the body, the survival is the most important thing. Your mind and your body don't necessarily want you to like be in your happiest, most fulfilled state. It just wants you to survive. So if you think about it that way, it makes a lot of sense. And this actually relates as well to depression, which a lot of research has kind of come out in which we can actually conceptualize depression as sickness behavior. So if you think about it, depression often involves kind of going into your room by yourself, sleeping a lot, maybe some weight gain, not being interested in the things that you typically would have been interested in the past, and just kind of a very low energy state. And it's like, why would this happen? Like, why would this happen to humans? Like, why would we get depressed? But now that we kind of see this survival switch, we understand that maybe a low energy state and not wanting to interact a lot with others and just kind of wanting to, like, you know, sleep in your bed the whole day and not do anything can actually be a potential survival behavior, in that not expending a lot of energy could actually have protected you in the past in dying in a famine or during a time that there was no food available. So there's quite a bit of research that correlates metabolic syndrome or obesity with depression, and I think there's a massive link between the two. I don't think that these things just happen randomly. I think there's a really good reason for these things to happen. And this is, I think, really good news, actually, because essentially we're able to create more protocols to help with these diseases, in that we're not needing to just target depression from a psychological standpoint, but we can actually target it from a biological standpoint as well, in that we're also targeting our like physical bodies, because the mind and the body are not necessarily separate. They are very much conjoined. And what affects our mind also affects our body. So now that we can kind of understand that certain things that we eat actually trigger a survival switch in our bodies and in our minds that lead to what I would call sickness behavior, weight gain, low energy, not feeling our greatest. And that essentially means that we're entering almost like a semi-hibernation state as a protective way to cope with low energy resources. Then what we can do is we can look at the things that trigger the survival switch and we cannot engage with them. So in my reading of the book, there were really three things that stood out to me that were important behaviors to do in order to not trigger the survival switch and to not increase the likelihood of metabolic disease or psychological illness. And these things are fairly simple. So the first is to decrease salt intake or increase water intake. Either one will work. So if you just can't give up your salt and you need to eat a lot of salt, like you can't not eat it, then if you just actually increase your water intake substantially, then you can not trigger that survival switch. So there's a lot of science behind this that's in the book, but I'm not gonna bore you too much with it because the purpose of this video is for anyone that maybe doesn't have time to read the book and just kind of wants to know what to do. And so the second thing that's really important to do in order to not trigger your survival switch is to limit your intake of processed foods. And the reason for this is because, as we remember, fructose is kind of the culprit in triggering this survival switch. And so many processed foods are laden with fructose. Like it's like the cocaine of fructose. Like the fructose that exists in fruit is not the same as the fructose that they're putting in certain processed foods. So additionally, processed foods are often really high in sodium, which goes back to point number one. So they're just not great for us. And that also makes sense why we would experience kind of this obesity epidemic at this point in time, because 100 years ago, we just did not have the types of processed foods we have now. Okay, and then most importantly, it is to limit your fructose consumption or really any type of added sugar or sugary beverage, sugary dessert, anything that just is gonna hit your bloodstream with a high amount of sucrose or fructose, because we know that the body can actually convert sucrose to fructose, so that can also trigger the survival switch. So if you think about it, it's essentially kind of the advice of not eating a lot of sugar, which is like, duh, right? But now that we know exactly why we shouldn't eat a lot of sugar, I think it might make it a little bit easier. And what you want to do is really limit the amount of sugar that's eaten and also the amount that is entering your body in one instance. So we know that, for instance, like eating an apple after a meal, that fructose is completely fine. Our body can digest that, it can handle it, like we are equipped to do this. But drinking 2 cups of apple juice is not something that we're equipped to deal with. That again is kind of fructose on crack. Like it is just too much for our biology to handle, and it's not something that we really were made or equipped to do. And that will trigger the survival switch, because that signaling of fructose to the body essentially is like if a bear goes and gorges on a bunch of berries. Like that's just way too much fructose for us to handle, and to us, that to our bodies, that is a signal that this is time to switch that survival switch, to start going into the hibernation state, and to essentially increase our fat storage, lower our energy, and prepare ourselves for that inevitable famine that humans and primates have seen over and over again historically. And so if you're someone that eats a lot of salt, or maybe eats a lot of processed food, or really enjoys a lot of kind of sugary things that have been processed, again, a single piece of fruit is not gonna do a huge amount of damage, then this is actually really good news, because essentially you have the opportunity to change your behavior that could really, really positively affect your physical and psychological health. And I think that's actually really great. And so I hope this video was useful. And I'm wondering, do you all like this type of kind of mind, body, medicine type of content? If you do, comment below and let me know, because to me, this is a huge area of interest of mine, but I'm not sure if you all enjoy it as much as I do. And if you do end up picking up Dr. Johnson's book, I highly recommend it. It's phenomenal. I read it as an audiobook. It took me like one day at 1.7 speed. If you're trying to read more books, this is the way to do it. I have an Audible link below. I actually have a link that will give you a free audiobook. So if you click that link, you can just go ahead and get this Nature Wants Us to Be Fat for free. And you can just go ahead and read it really quickly. I highly recommend. And I think the science is super interesting. So if you're interested in the science, I think this would be really enjoyable for you. And if you're not, I hope that these takeaways were helpful to you and they help you make more informed decisions in your life. All right, I will be back again next week with another video, and I hope you all have a wonderful week.